Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the 16th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2022. The first item of business we have is for members of the committee to consider whether or not to take agenda items 3, 4 and 5 in private. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Thank you very much. The principal item of business we've got on our agenda this morning is to take evidence from representatives of the civil service in the Scottish Government about the procurement and arrangements around the delivery of vessels 801 and 802, which has been the subject of a detailed Section 23 report by the Auditor General. So can I welcome our witnesses this morning? I want to begin by welcoming Mo Rooney, who joins us online. Mo is the Deputy Director of Strategic Commercial Interventions at the Scottish Government. Mo, if at points you want to come in, if you indicate in the chat function, that would be helpful, and we'll try and do our best to bring you in. But you may be given delegated responsibility by members of the panel to answer questions as well. But I would also like to welcome Roy Brannan, who is the Interim Director General of the Net Zero Department of the Scottish Government, Colin Cook, who's the Director of Economic Development. We're also joined by Dermot Rattican, who is the Deputy of the Manufacturing and Industries Section. Hugh Gillis is the Interim Chief Executive of Transport Scotland. Fran Pacitti is the Director of Aviation, Maritime, Freight and Canals at Transport Scotland, and Chris Wilcock, who's the head of the Ferries Unit at Transport Scotland. You are all welcome. What I'd like to do to begin with is to ask Roy Brannan to give us an opening statement, and then members of the committee have got questions that we'd like to put to you. But Roy Brannan, first of all.
Thank you, Kavir. Good morning, Convener, Committee members. Thank you for the invitation to provide evidence this morning. I recognise that the decisions around vessels 801 and 802 and Scottish Government's support for Ferguson's are areas of significant interest. My colleagues and I welcome the opportunity to support the committee by answering any questions that you may have. As is clear from the scope and the detail in the Auditor General's report, the issues here are complex and cover a period of several years. I'd like to begin by recording my thanks to staff at Audit Scotland for the very measured and professional way in which they engaged in the preparation of their report, and by acknowledging and the significant effort of my colleagues across Transport Scotland and the Scottish Government in seeking to engage openly and constructively throughout the Audit Scotland's work. We are here in number today. That reflects the range of issues addressed in the Audit Scotland report and our desire to ensure that you have access to the right people and the information that you need. It goes without saying that people have moved on in their careers since the project began in 2014, some to other roles in government and some having left the Scottish Government entirely. We have brought witnesses to the inquiry to have the best knowledge of events, either through their direct experience in current or previous roles, or where that has not been possible, through an understanding of issues in their current roles. We were in touch with the clerks in advance of the session to map out our respective areas of involvement. Alongside me today, I have Colin Cook, Mo Rooney and Dermot Rattican from DG Economy, who will be able to speak to issues around nationalisation of the yard, ongoing progress with the vessels and loan funding to FMEL. I, along with Hugh Gillis, Fran and Chris Wilcock from Transport Scotland, will be able to cover the other matters relating to initial delivery of the vessels and contract issues. I will try to direct questions across the panel of witnesses accordingly. We have accepted all of the recommendations in Audit Scotland report, and we do, of course, accept that the outcome in relation to vessels 801 and 802 is not that for which we had hoped at the point of contract award. We don't take that lightly. This is still a live project with much work to be done, but as ever, we will endeavour to answer as many questions as we can to the best of our ability. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Brannan. I want to begin by putting a question to you and to Hugh Gillis as well, but I'll take you first, Mr. Brannan. I mean, you mentioned about current and previous roles. You've both held the post of designated accountable officer for Transport Scotland. So can you outline to the committee what is required in this role? First of all, in providing formal advice to ministers, but secondly, recording decisions, particularly where significant concerns or significant risks are involved.
Yeah, so I took up role as accountable officer of TS as CEO in November 2015. And it's fair to say, as an executive agency, there's a fairly well-defined structure of accountability within the agency. And SPFM and the Public Finance Act sets out what that responsibility is for an accountable officer. So first and foremost, signing the accounts for expenditure and income. Secondly, overseeing the regulatory and proprietary issues of the finance that's at your disposal. And then using the resources economically, efficiently and effectively as possible, and undertaking all the work of the agency. And the agency's work encompasses both policy, operations and delivery. So in respect of how we engage with ministers in that, ministers set strategic direction, the policy, the budget, and then the job of the CEO and the accountable officer is to set the governance structure and the arrangements internally within the organisation to deliver on ministers' wishes. And that's how we go about the business. So on issues of investment decisions, we have an investment decision committee chaired by the chief executive of TS. And that committee looks at the business cases for investments prior to that decision going forward to ministers. Now, in 2015, that IDM approach was principally concerned with major projects, so Queens Ferry Crossing, A9, M8, 73, 74. But one of the changes that have been made since the report has come out is that all ferry infrastructure now, port harbour infrastructure and ferries, also now go through that IDM approach. I'll pause there because that's quite a long answer.
Okay, thanks. Hugh Gillis, do you want to add anything to that?
Yeah, thank you, Chair. So I came into post on November last year, and as Roy has set out there, I inherited the responsibilities for TS Accountable Officer, and all the responsibilities that go with that in terms of SPFM and the Civil Service Code. One of the first things across my desk, as Roy's been sort of intimating, was an IDM in relation to the Isle of Ferries contract. And I'm obviously very much aware of the history of 801, 802. One of the first things I did, of course, when that came across my desk was to work and turn to Fran as my director for EMFC and Chris as head of ferries. And obviously when that IDM paper came to me to have discussions with Fran and Chris going into that particular process and to discuss that, we made sure that all the requirements, propriety, value for money, etc., were all part of that overall process of the IDM that brought forward the Isle of Ferries. But we can maybe talk about that at length maybe later if you wish.
Okay, thank you. Can I just take you back to some evidence that we took from the Auditor General, which is about correspondence at the time of the 8th and 9th of October, which took place between your predecessor as the Chief Executive of Transport Scotland and government ministers. So there was an email from Transport Scotland reflecting CMAL's concerns about the award of the contract to FMEL. And the board went so far as to say that they felt it was their absolute duty to point out the risk to their shareholder, and in that respect would expect approval should the Scottish Government wish this project to proceed and to receive direction to that effect. And the next day, the reply is submitted to Eric Ostergaard from the Director of Aviation, Maritime, Freight and Canals, your predecessor, Fran Pachitti, where Transport Scotland uses the word authorised. It says that they are authorised to enter into the contracts and any associated documentations. And at the bottom of that letter, it says, I can confirm that the Scottish ministers have considered and approved the contents of this letter. I mean, one of the issues that's at stake here is about whether written authority from ministers was sought, was secured but not recorded, or whether it doesn't constitute that at all. I wonder whether, Mr. Brannan, first of all, whether you can address that point.
So I've reviewed the correspondence that's come forward, and from what I can see is that the Director of Aviation, Maritimes, Ferries and Canals at that point has presented all the evidence, all the risks, all the consideration to ministers in seeking ministers' approval to allow CMAL to award the contract. What I don't know, and I know that you've written out to Mr. Middleton to seek his view, is what consideration he had as the AO on whether or not any written authority was required. Now, having looked at it and referring back to those earlier points I made on the SPFM, the last part on the SPFM talks around if you are asked to do something that is not in the normal circumstances related to the proper performance of the duties above, then you should seek written authority. And I think in this case, there was no need to do that. And as the Auditor General said in his report, there was no authority sought and no direction given.
Okay, but in light of the view of CMAL, which also reports directly to the ministerial team, why do you not think that what they were asking for was written authority?
So I think the first part of that sentence was that they were looking for approval to award the contract. I don't know whether the language they used was specific. It could have been clearer, but they were certainly looking for approval from ministers to award the contract. And in the normal course of events, that would be the case. So if we were investing in a major project, then once it had passed their IDM processes, we would be seeking ministerial approval to continue on with whatever the next stage of that process would be.
And who would they be seeking ministerial approval from?
So that would be the depending on the issue in hand. So if it's a transport project, then that would be the Minister for Transport. So if it's entirely within their portfolio, and that was the decision entirely for the Minister, then that would be for the Minister. If it's a wider issue, i.e. bringing ScotRail into public ownership, then that might be something that is considered much wider than a single minister, because it's got a wider Scotland approach.
But so when you say it's entirely for the minister, then the Cabinet Secretary for Finance doesn't have a role in that?
No. So the Cabinet Secretary for Finance would agree the budget, which he did, and he doesn't have a role in signing off on the decision to sign off on CMAL awarding the contract rested with the Minister for Transport at the time.
And that wouldn't, for example, go to a cabinet meeting, for example?
No, not necessarily. There's no necessity, depending on scale or influence, for a particular issue to go forward to cabinet. If it can be dealt with by a ministerial portfolio issue, then it's dealt with by the minister. And as I say, the example I can give where a decision was taken at cabinet would have been ScotRail into public ownership, because of the gravity, the size of that decision, and the need for cabinet secretaries to be aware of that. But ferry contract, given all that we were procuring at that time, bearing in mind we had probably over £2-3 billion worth of work underway with Queen's Ferry Crossing, M8, 7374, Aberdeen West of Peripheral, ferries contract would have been entirely a decision for the Minister for Transport.
Even though the First Minister had been to the yard to announce that the contract had been awarded before the negotiations had been concluded.
So the contractor was awarded. It was announced as the preferred bidder. It wasn't awarded as the successful contractor. And I think that's an important distinction. So there is a period of time beyond preferred bidder announcement to actual contract signing. And the contract was signed in, I think it was middle of October in the end.
So when the First Minister stands up in Parliament and says that in the end she's responsible, she wasn't involved in this decision, is that what you're saying?
Correct. So the decision, as the paper trail demonstrates, was taken directly by the information provided by the Director at the time up to the Transport Minister. Transport Minister considered it and responded accordingly. The First Minister, I think, in Parliament has said that they have collective responsibility for all decisions, and that's correct. So if the decision is taken by the Minister for Transport, then collectively everybody then is locked into that.
Yeah, you mentioned paper trails. I mean, one of the big concerns expressed in the report that the Auditor General produced was the lack of paper trails, the lack of paperwork to cover the implications of the decision being awarded, the decision to award the contract under the circumstances it was awarded and the risks that that entailed. You know, what's your reflection on that?
So it was regrettable that we couldn't identify that exchange back. It was covered, obviously, in the exchange that Mr. Nichols put back to CMAL, but actually with a bit further investigation by Fran and their records team, it did turn up, and that just confirmed that the Minister had indeed made that decision, had considered the evidence in front of him, had made the decision and responded accordingly. There are over 210 documents publicly available and have been since 2015. Those documents cover a wide range of exchanges with CABSECs, ministers, on various issues as we went through the whole process of trying to get these vessels into the water and into the community's hands. So I accept that on this occasion, this one bit of paper was not easy to find, but we did find it. Our focus is on record keeping more generally going forward, and I know the PermSec has written recently to the Finance and Public Administration Committee on the new strategy that we have in place to improve on our records management.
Sorry, Mr. Brannan, but and I'll come to the recent correspondence between the Permanent Secretary and the Finance and Public Administration Committee of this Parliament. But you just said there that the piece of paper had been found. I mean, that's not the view of Audit Scotland, is it? Their view is the piece of paper that was found and presented to Parliament a couple of weeks ago represented more information on who, and now you said it was entirely the Minister for Transport. That seemed to suggest actually the Cabinet Secretary for Finance was involved in that process. But the piece of paper that was presented does not fill the gap that has been identified by the Auditor General, which is that there is no substantial recording of the considerations of ministers and their response to the risks that were clearly identified by CMAL in presenting this contract to Ferguson Marine.
Well, I don't accept that. I think the information that was put forward by Transport Scotland, as referenced by the Auditor General in the report, that we put forward the entire case of what the risks were associated with this contract award, the consideration of that is for the Minister. Now, how he chooses to respond to that is entirely up to the Minister. And in this case, he responded saying, I can't remember the exact words, but he was content for the contract to be awarded. But he had in front of him everything he needed to make that decision. Now, on other occasions that we will, as we put advice up to ministers, they potentially will respond and ask further questions on a particular issue. In this case, there was no exchange of that nature, as far as I can see from the paperwork. And in terms of the DFM's involvement in that exchange, again, with responsibility for finance and budget, it's right that there's a final check done on whether there's any other finance or budget requirements. And that's what that exchange between the Chief Financial Officer, as I understand it, Gordon Wales, and the DFM was.
Okay, but you're saying that it's the responsibility of the Minister, but it's the responsibility of the civil service to give the Minister advice on issues around the value for money, the propriety and the regularity of the contract that's about to be entered into. And under some circumstances, if it's believed that the deal it runs contrary to those values, then written authority would be expected.
Correct. But as I say, in this case, I suspect that you could have argued that it could have been laid out differently, but all the key considerations were included in that exchange that went up from the director. Now, what you will no doubt wish to ask Mr. Middleton is what consideration he had on the basis of that information as to whether or not that departed from the duties of the AO. And as I say, there's nothing in there that suggests to me that that was something that he considered to be required.
OK, thanks. We are limited for time, so I've just got one other question to put in before I bring Willie Coffey in. But it's you alluded to the Permanent Secretary, who has recently been in correspondence with the Finance and Public Administration Committee, where he said there is no overarching statutory duty to record all decisions in a particular way. I mean, do you consider that this lack of a statutory duty contributed to the failure to record this important decision made by Scottish ministers to award this contract on the 9th of October 2015?
No, there isn't a statutory duty, but there is a duty under the Civil Service Code. So under the Civil Service Code, there is a requirement for us as officers to use evidence in our deliberations, to record advice that goes to ministers. And again, as I say, in this case, I believe that John Nicholls, as the director, has done that and recorded that exchange. And now that we've got the bit of paper that explains that the minister did accept that, then that's the totality of that exchange.
Well, I think we may well return to that. But Willie Coffey wants to come in.
Thanks, Convener. It's just a supplementary follow-up on that line of questioning there by the Convener, Mr. Brannan. Do you think the extent to which some parties are placing particular emphasis on paper trails and recording of decisions is a fair reflection on how government actually works in practice? Are we dealing with unmet expectation here by some, or are we dealing with failures to deliver on requirements? What side of that line would you say we're in with this particular issue? Because it's been a recurring issue for the committee and others for quite some time now.
Yeah, I mean, what if it would be helpful? I mean, you could see the exchange that's occurred on the Isle of Wessels, for instance, and demonstrate that process of both approvals, clearing through IDM, and then for ministers to accept and deliberate on what those decisions are. All of those are done. Any investments are done in that particular way, with a paper trail, with that advice going up, and with recommendations seeking ministerial approval. There's also good examples within the audit trail paperwork that's available online in relation to the latter part of 2019, when CBC had suggested a different approach to nationalisation. And you'll see in there a fairly detailed piece of response from the Director General at the time, Liz Ditchburn, and myself on the AO considerations of that proposition. And it quite clearly sets out, in terms of propriety, regulatory and value for money, that the recommendation could not be taken forward. So I think there is good evidence that decisions are recorded properly by the civil service. I admittedly, you could argue that in this case, you could have demonstrated that differently with the way that it was presented. But all the right evidence was there. Everything that was in front of Mr. Nicholls was presented to the minister for him to consider.
Okay, thank you. Happy to hand back, Convener.
Thank you. Can I just go back to something that you said in your opening remarks, Mr. Brannan, which is that you accept in full all of the recommendations of the Audit Scotland report, but you don't seem to accept that recommendation which says that there was a huge gap in the supporting paperwork that was required to be logged that lay behind the decision that was taken to award the contract to FMIL.
So I think I need to check what the recommendation was, but I think the recommendation would have been on the basis that concluding piece of information was not available at that time. Now, subsequent to the production of the report, that piece of information is available.
Okay. Well, maybe it was a conclusion as well as a or more than a recommendation. But anyway, look, I want to invite in Sharon Dowie, who's got some questions to put to you. Sharon.
Thank you. Good morning. Just again, some additional ones and things that the convener's already asked. So, the Public Records Scotland Act 2011, you have to keep records and someone is responsible for keeping records. So why was this not complied with? Because this seems to be the biggest issue we've got, is the fact that we don't have enough records to show decisions that were made.
Well, as I say, repeating myself, that the record is there and is kept and is public.
Right. In the evidence session that we had with Auditor General for Scotland, he confirmed that in the absence of formal written authority under the terms of the Scottish Public Finance Manual in Scotland, if an accountable officer does not request such written authority, the accountability for the decision rests with the accountable officer. So why would the accountable officer not have obtained this, and why would it not have been stored safely due to the number of issues that have been raised throughout?
So if I come back to what I said originally in terms of SPFM and the Public Finance Act, so the consideration for an AO is on those three points of signing accounts for expenditure and income, for the propriety and regulatory issues around finance, and for the efficient, effective and and economic use of finance. The next part of that says that if the accountable officer is asked to do something that he considers would not be in the normal performance of those duties above, then he should seek written authority. And all I can say is that the accountable officer at the time, Mr. Middleton, must have had that consideration. So it's entirely appropriate for individual accountable officers to make that consideration, whether or not to seek a written authority. And in this case, no written authority was sought or given, as the Auditor General has reported in his report.
Can I ask how long Mr. Middleton was in the role for?
So he left at the end of October and I took up post in the beginning of November. And I think David was in post longer than me, heading towards 7 years, I suspect. So I was 6 years. I think he was still the longest serving CEO of TS.
Experienced in his role then?
Yes.
So was there a reason? Was it another job he left for? What was the reason for him leaving so soon after the contract was signed?
So he was moving on to become Chief Exec of Historic Environment Scotland at the time, and then subsequently to that he retired. He was he's off that age. So
he moved on to another
correct
government position. Right, okay. So just talking about the accountabilities, some of the ones are ensures risks are managed effectively, make sure procurement guidelines are met, seek written authority from ministers if any action is inconsistent with proper performance of the accountable officer's functions. And I know one of the comments you made earlier was that the job is to deliver on ministers' wishes. So why would somebody with 7 years' experience not go and put all that into place? Because there's been numerous concerns raised with the contracts. Why would somebody with that amount of experience not get confirmation from a minister, written confirmation on the decisions that were made?
Well, I think they did. I mean, John put forward, the Director of Aviation put forward all the considerations in relation to the contract award and sought ministerial approval on the back of that. That's the paperwork that I've got in front of me. So I'm reviewing the same paperwork as the committee has. I haven't spoken to John or to Mr. Middleton. I know that you have written to both or at least one to get written evidence. But I'm not sure I can add anything further to that.
I just find it hard to believe that he's not got that. In the letter dated 20th of August 2015 to the Cabinet Secretary for Infrastructure, Investment and Cities, various issues are raised. Ministerial approval was sought by the 27th of August, just 7 days after receiving the letter. And this was due to the Minister being on holiday. So it states that the date had already been extended for 2 months. This was for signing the contract. So paragraph 8 states, CalMAC will not be in a position to fully endorse the shipbuilding documentation by the required deadline. Further efforts will be undertaken during the detailed design of the vessel by FMEL to address any outstanding points. And it also highlights issues concerning the access of the vessels to various ports they may serve, requirement for modifications at some ports. The vessels are dual fuel. LNG brings some logistic challenges and may require some additional fueling infrastructure. So there was lots of issues being raised, other than just the ferries, infrastructure ones as well. Why was there such a last-minute rush to get this signed off? Because it had already been extended by 2 months. The minister goes on holiday and it was then given to the Cabinet Secretary to sign off. So why was there such a last-minute rush? Is it because of the number of issues in the contract?
No, I'll bring in Fran here, but I don't think there was a rush to sign it off. I think CMAL, in negotiating with the bidder, trying to get to a point where they could sign the contract, took a period over 2 months to get those final issues resolved from preferred bidder to contract award. I don't think that's a rush procedure in terms of CMAL as the procuring authority, bearing in mind that Transport Scotland don't have a role in the contract. This is between CMAL as the buyer and FMEL as the builder. Had to satisfy themselves that they were able to enter that contract and resolve whatever issues that were apparent. But Fran, is there anything else you want to add?
I don't think there's anything to add to that, Roy. It doesn't. I wouldn't categorise it as being a rushed process. CMAL may be able to offer more in terms of their direct experience of that procurement process. It is typical from the period from preferred bidder to conclusion of the contract for there to be refinement of the contract terms. And it would have been recorded in the advice to Minister, just in line with the very obligations that you've set out and the desire to make sure that there is a full record of risks and issues that are there. But I'm not aware of there having been any particular rush, nor for Minister's holiday arrangements to have influenced the timing of decisions in any way.
So was there a communication issue then? Because I'm just thinking the Minister that you're saying is responsible for signing it off, and you're saying that it would only have been Derek Mackay, who was the Minister at the time, so there wouldn't have been any other involvement. He had the authority to go and sign that off, but would there not have been communication between him, Transport Scotland, CMAL, etc., to get this contract signed, and he just goes on holiday? And it's then passed to Keith Brown to sign it off, who has, as you're saying, wouldn't have had any knowledge of it in advance, because it would only have been Derek Mackay that was signing it off.
Well, Mr. Mackay, as Transport Minister, we've been reporting to the CAPSEC, so under that portfolio. So, and the advice would have been the same to either CAPSEC or Minister. So if a Minister isn't available, then I am assuming that between the Minister and the CAPSEC, they have agreed who will take decisions in their absence. But I'm in an area that is, you know, I wasn't party to these discussions or these exchanges at that time. And as I say, I know that you have written to former colleagues to seek their evidence.
Just for the record, we haven't written to them yet. We have indicated that we are going to write to them, but the letter hasn't dropped through their letterboxes yet.
My apologies.
That's fine. I'm going to bring in Craig Hoy at this point, and I can come back to Sharon Dowie shortly.
Thank you, Convener. Just for a point of clarification, just put on the record. In your view, which minister took the final decision to proceed with the contract?
Minister for Transport.
So that would be Derek Mackay?
Correct.
So he took the final decision?
Correct.
And which minister signed the contract?
Oh, God. Yeah, sorry, the procuring authority was between CMAL and as the buyer and FML as the builder. So no minister signed the contract.
No minister signed the contract. So CMAL, that had significant concerns, that they raised them with ministers, then signs the contract. So was CMAL overruled, or were their views ignored?
No, so their views were put entirely to the minister. Minister considered those views, responded accordingly to the officials who were engaged as the sponsored body of CMAL, and reported back to CMAL. And as I understand it, and I know that you'll be speaking to CMAL, the CMAL board were comfortable with that and then subsequently awarded the contract.
But if I advise you not to do something in pretty strong terms and then you proceed to do it, I'm either being ignored or overruled, haven't I?
So are you referring to the letter from the chair at the end of September and the subsequent exchanges that went in to the minister? So there was from the moment that the chair had expressed concern to the point at which the advice went up to minister, quite a bit of negotiation had happened, as I understand it, between CMAL and FMAL on getting the contract to a place where both parties were content. So at that point, CMAL were content to award the contract and were seeking approval from the minister to do so. That approval was sought, given, and responded to CMAL, and the board accepted that and then signed the contract on, I think, the 19th of October or thereabouts, Fran?
Well, I'm just looking back at the Exhibit 1 in the Auditor General's report. September, CMAL advises Transport Scotland of the significant risks of awarding the contract to FMAL and states its preference to start the procurement process again. October, Transport Scotland advises CMAL that Scottish ministers are aware of the risks and are content for CMAL to award the contract to FMAL. It's quite clear either their wishes were ignored or they were overruled.
Again, it comes back to my answer that the information that CMAL had raised in terms of their concerns were presented to ministers in totality with the advice that had gone forward from the director. Ministers considered that advice and then responded accordingly to approve CMAL to award the contract, which they did.
Okay, we've touched on quite clearly who took the decision, although I still have real concerns about that. But we don't understand why. When are we going to get to the why, and what changed materially to allow CMAL to set aside all those very significant concerns, so much so that they wanted to reopen the procurement process? Where is the documentary evidence that the Auditor General requested to say why was the decision, why was the final decision taken? because if there's significant sounds in September, we don't know what changed between September and October. You know, surely all the research you must have done for coming before us today, you must have a greater understanding of what changed.
So I think that, again, it comes back to the documentation that went forward from John Nicholls, Director of Aviation, to the Minister. That had all the considerations contained within it, including the mitigations that CMAL had managed to negotiate with the builder at that time to get themselves comfortable that they were able to award the contract. So if you read the exchanges, then it explains that at the initial stage, that the no refund guarantee was too far adrift from where they needed to be. And at the point where the advice had gone up to ministers, CMAL had managed to negotiate a position where they had both a refund guarantee for 25% and a final payment of 25%, so reduced the risk. That risk, in their view, was manageable. And again, I'm speaking probably on behalf of others who you're about to see, including CMAL, so they will wish to present their own evidence on that. But that's, from my reading of the paperwork, that's where it got to in terms of the ministerial decision.
Okay. So you're absolutely certain nobody was overruled, or there was no threat to overrule anyone?
No.
Completely certain?
Yes.
So you can be certain about that, but you're not certain about what those discussions were because you weren't there?
Well, I'm certain on the basis of the information that's been presented to the Minister and what I'm able to review. So the advice that Mr Nicholls put up to the Minister included both the exchange from the chairman of CMAL to John Nicholls at the time in September, the further consideration that CMAL executives had on the negotiation with the contract, the draft voted loan letter that was to go back out from officials to CMAL, and set out very clearly what the risks were, and for the Minister to consider all that evidence and then to opine on whether or not he was content to approve the award of the contract. That's what I've got in front of me.
OK, fine. I just want to ask a little bit about the way the culture of the way that government works, because obviously there are formal channels and there are back channels. For example, when did you last speak to the First Minister?
When did I speak to the First Minister? I can't recall. It's not any time recently. I suspect it might have been. In fact, it was probably a month ago when she came out to speak to the ET in an informal environment.
Did you discuss ferries?
No.
Okay. So you would accept, however, the principle that when you're in discussion with ministers, there can be minuted discussions, but there can also be discussions that can be had, the kind of water cooler moments. Are you certain that everything that needed to be recorded around that time, principally those critical 24 hours in October, are you certain that everything that needed to be recorded was recorded?
So I think there's always regular dialogue with ministers. I think that's what you're alluding to. And on regular business, daily business, that's the case. I think when it comes to important decisions, decisions of investment, decisions of policy, then those are recorded. And I think that's the distinction. And in this case, what I've got in front of me is the paperwork trail that records that particular decision around the award.
But the Auditor General doesn't think that paper trail is sufficient.
Well again, it depends on what the Auditor General feels should be the response that comes back from private office and ministers. And that can vary. So you can have a response that comes back on a particular issue that sets out verbatim what the recommendations are and the advice that goes up. So if the minister, if the policy officials put a piece of advice up that says, we recommend you do A, B, C and D, then on occasions, private office will come back and say the minister has considered the advice that's gone forward and reflecting back those recommendations. On other occasions, it can be as simple as a one line which says the minister has fully considered the advice and is content. And on other occasions, it could be the minister has further questions to ask in response to this advice and would welcome a meeting or would welcome further exchanges on the advice itself. In this case, the response that came back was as documented in the information that you've got.
So you're saying the Auditor General got it wrong?
I'm not saying you got it wrong. All I'm saying is that that's the interpretation of my interpretation of the documentation that I have, that the information that went forward was full, that the response that came back was the minister's view, his own view, there's no set template on how the minister comes back. And in that response, he has opined that he has considered and is content for the contract to be awarded.
OK, and just we'll come back in later, but just one final question. You mentioned the Investment Decision Committee. Did the Investment Decision Committee consider the ferries in 2015? And if not, who did?
No. So IDM, and I'll bring Fran and Hugh here, IDM at that point was principally concerned with major investment, major projects of the scale of Queens Ferry Crossing, for instance. It didn't look at port infrastructure or vessels or other investment across TS. That subsequently changed, and you know, as we move forward, those big decisions, smaller amounts of money, but still unique in their nature, comes forward through the IDM process. So formal business cases, different stages, gateway reviews, and then cleared by the IDM challenge session. And at that point, the advice would go forward to Minister to say, we've concluded the IDM, we have the business case, we have the gateway review findings, and our recommendation is to do A, B or C. But Fran or Hugh?
So the Investment Decision-Making Board of Transport Scotland is a piece of governance within the agency which is designed to support the Chief Executive in his role as accountable officer. And it is designed to be a challenge function before any significant decisions are taken, so at strategic business case stage or subsequent stages in a project. And it supplements the gateway review processes and other assurance and governance arrangements that you would expect to see in place. Vessels 801 and 802 were not taken to the Investment Decision Board. I can't speak to the reasons for that at that time. The threshold and the range of projects which come forward to Investment Decision Board has changed over time as that governance has evolved and continues to evolve. But I have found it beneficial in my period and post to take significant projects to IDM to benefit from that challenge and to assist with the assurance process and in supporting the Chief Executive in their AO function.
And if I may, obviously it's my responsibility now to chair these IDMs. And as Fran has said, I'm very much of the view when I have run them, and to be fair, when Roy was Chief Exec, he did the same. So obviously, when it comes to that, it's very much for the directors of Transport Scotland. They get the papers in advance. They're expected to read them thoroughly. If need be, we get our project team to come in and they'll do a presentation on it. And then I will open up the discussion and invite every director to offer comment, and we will reach a view. Sometimes we will send the project team away because we're not satisfied with the responses we've had to some of the challenges. So it's certainly not a tick box exercise, I can assure you of that. It can be quite uncomfortable for some directors, and they get quite heated and disappointed when they're sent away. But the serious point is that the challenge function is there, and rightly so, because my responsibility, obviously, under the SBFM and the Civil Service Code is very much at the heart of that.
Just a final question, Mr. Brannan. You said you were aware that we'd written out to future potential witnesses, but you said you hadn't spoken to Mr. Middleton. So how were you aware that we'd written out if you haven't spoken to anybody?
I think it was through the clerk that suggested that. In fact, it was social media that you tweeted out that you were going to seek evidence from Mr. Middleton and other employees. So that's where I saw it.
Okay. I'm going to now bring Willie Coffey in because he's been itching to come in.
Thanks again, Convener. Again, it's a supplementary follow-up to my colleague Craig Hoy. Mr. Brannan, you've heard the Convener raising issues about the whole decision-making process and record-keeping issues, and you've heard my colleague Craig Hoy highlighting the issue about risk and proper consideration of risks, which are central to some of the issues that we're facing now. In your view, are the issues that have been raised about those two areas, were they sufficient, do you think, to have invited the government to reach a different decision about the procurement of these vessels?
So I think the singular piece of evidence to rely on there, at least to consider, is the written advice from CMAL executive to Mr. Nicholls, and then subsequently Mr. Nicholls up to the minister, where it talks about the management of that risk in terms of the refund guarantee changing and the mitigations put in place and what the residual risk was. And again, I don't have the bit of paperwork in front of me, but it talks about, I think, from recollection, there was a medium level of risk remaining, if you like, with the delivery of the vessels, that it then goes on to explain a number of scenarios that may or may not happen, i.e. if there is insolvency, then the title of all the different parts, etc., has now been secured on behalf of the buyer. So it lays out what the level of risk that was in CMIL's mind remaining at that point, having negotiated a different set of outcomes with the builder.
Mm-hmm. And had the government not proceeded with the procurement of the vessels, what would the impact have been? What would be the outcome?
So at that time, if the procurement had not gone forward, then it would have been a retendering exercise and start from scratch. And obviously at that time, a delay to the introduction of those vessels into service and the impact on communities on that.
OK. Thanks again. Back to you again, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you. Before I bring in Colin Beattie, I just want to go back to something that Fran Pachiti said, which I thought was an extremely important point, which is about the role of challenge in making decisions. Because in the end, this was £97 million of public money, and we now know it's ended up being considerably more than that. And so the role of challenge for those decisions, it seems to me, is absolutely primary. And as the Public Audit Committee of the Parliament, it's something that we would expect. So, I mean, could you explain a bit more about the relationship that there ought to be between the Portfolio Accountable Officer and this decision-making? And could you also explain whether there is a role in this process for the DG Finance, for example? I mean, isn't part of their role to challenge investment decisions taken at portfolio level to see if they meet the tests that are set out in the Public Finance Manual?
So I think in terms of the executive agency, the accountable officer is the chief executive, and it's entirely right that they are the responsible officer for those investment decisions and those challenge functions. And as I say, the IDM approach is our mechanism on which to ensure that before any decision is taken, that these are thoroughly tested in terms of value for money, whether or not they are still addressing the outcomes that we are seeking in policy terms before that advice goes up to ministers. And as Hugh has explained previously, and during my tenure, there were a number of occasions where particular initiatives would come forward and they weren't developed enough, or they didn't demonstrate that they produced a positive BCR, and the teams were sent away to look at how best we could deliver a different policy, the same policy outcome, but with a different option. And that kind of approach to major projects is the one that we are applying now to all our infrastructure projects, including ports and harbours, and the join up of those two issues. So some of the lessons that have come out of this has meant that what Fran and the team are now required to do is to consider not just the vessel replacement, but also the port infrastructure required to support that vessel replacement, and to bring those two things together to IDM in a business case format to ensure that those are thoroughly tested and challenged before CMAL are allowed to go out and award any contracts.
But again, for the avoidance of doubt, I think Fran Pachetti said earlier on that didn't happen with the case of ferries vessels 801 and 802.
Correct. So back in 15, and I suspect it was probably as a result of how IDM was focused in at that time, it was principally relating to our major projects. So the £1.35 billion Queens Ferry Crossing, Aberdeen West Peripheral, you know, large-scale investment decisions, substantive decisions, and smaller amounts of investment did not flow through that process. Unique projects flew through that process. So if it was a unique IT project, for instance, then that would have been expected to come through the IDM process. But that subsequently changed to include a much wider range of investment.
So, I'm not sure I got a question on an answer to my question about the challenge and the role of the Director General of Finance. But when I'm looking at the Transport Scotland framework document published in 2012, so the one that was applicable at the time of the award of these contracts, it does say quite clearly in there that that one of the roles of the Portfolio Accountable Officer within the DG is to challenge. I mean, Roy Brannan, you're now in the role of being the DG in the relevant department, albeit it's changed its name, and formerly you were the Chief Executive of Transport Scotland, the agency. I mean, don't you see that there should have been a role, or was there a role of challenge by the DG, accountable officer?
Well, as I say, I can't recollect entirely, but I don't think the DG had much of a role in terms of challenge of what was what the investment decisions were at that point. Those were direct between the CEO and ministers. In my current role, and if Hugh brings forward an issue that has gone through the IDM process and raises that with me, then I in turn will, I'm copied into all the various correspondence that goes up to ministers, and will pick up from that exchanges what there is to for me to be involved in terms of deciding on whether or not I should see much more information about a particular issue or not. ScotRail into public ownership, for example.
Okay, but from what we've heard this morning, though, the lines of challenge that we would expect to be in place for a contract of this order don't appear to have been in place or not been operated or not worked, and this framework document appears to be a piece of paper that wasn't a lived document. That it was a framework document that gathered dust. It didn't lead to the correct challenges being made to those decisions.
I don't accept that. I suspect that that David, as the credible officer at that time, in his regular discussions with the DG, Graham Dixon, would have been appraising him of all the work that was underway within TS at that time. And as I say, the paperwork that was going forward, whether it was on this project or on Queensferry Crossing or on new trains, those would have been cited to the DG as they went forward to CAPSEC and ministers for consideration. So as well as the final decision, the gestation of a policy to implementation would have been exchanged between all of those parties, and it would have been entirely appropriate for the DG and the CEO to sit down if there was a particular issue or a particular issue that needed to be raised and for that to be considered.
Okay, well, I think our view of the concerns that were raised by CMAL extend beyond the description of being a particular issue. I think there were pretty comprehensive concerns about the risks involved in the placing of those orders. And can I ask for the third and final time whether there was a role in this process for the Director General of Finance?
So I don't believe so. So again, the DG Finance would not have ordinarily been involved in that. I guess the Chief Financial Officer would have been involved from a budget and financial perspective, which you can clearly see from the exchange he was. But ordinarily, the DG Finance would have been satisfied with the support structures that were put in place by the Chief Executive and the DG responsible for the portfolio in the management of both the resources and the budget and the delivery of the Minister's programme of works in delivering that effectively, and that's the position.
Right. Okay. Well, we don't know whether they were satisfied or not, we can speculate about whether, with the hindsight of what's happened to this project, whether satisfaction comes anywhere close to it. I'm going to invite Colin Beattie to come in an area of inquiry that he's got. Colin.
Thank you, Convener. Before I do, I'd like to just get a small clarification from yourselves. In paragraph 21 of the Auditor General's report, it starts that during the negotiations, and contrary to what was included in its bid, and this is in connection with the BRG. Now, the bid, as I understand it, it was mandatory that a BRG be provided. Subsequently, FML came back and said that we can't do it, that we can't provide that. The implication in the Auditor General's report is that they had accepted that in the original bid and then subsequently said that they couldn't fulfil that part of the bid. Elsewhere, there's reference to the fact that when FML completed their bid, they were silent on the subject of the BRG, so there was an assumption that they had accepted that. Can you just clarify that? Did they actually accept it, or was it assumed because they didn't challenge it that it was accepted?
I'll bring Fran in here, and again, you might want to check this in terms of the evidence session that you have with CMAL, but my understanding was that they raised no issues as part of the tender process in relation to any of those issues, including BRG. And in that respect, they submitted their tender accordingly. So Anybody that does that is by its nature accepting the terms and conditions of the tender as described in the ITT. But Fran?
I think that's correct. So at the point of submitting bids, all parties who had been invited to tender were invited to comment upon the terms and conditions that were set out in the standard BIMCO contract, which was clear around the requirement for guarantees. And Ferguson's, as I understand, didn't raise any comment in relation to that. And in line with standard procurement process, it was then assumed that they had accepted that by failure to have raised it at that point.
Is that in line with other bids? Is it the same approach? It's not
yes.
Something different?
No.
No. So there was every reason to believe at that point that FML were going to...
So I would defer to CMAL on the specific terms of the invitation to tender, but it is my understanding, and it's common practice in a procurement, that you would invite comments and your silence is taken as tacit acceptance, and I think that that's reflected in the Auditor General's report.
Okay, thanks for that clarification. I'd like to turn to something else than chasing pieces of paper. I'd like to chase the money. There's an awful lot of money going into FML, and I'll go through it in a little bit more detail in a second, but they received over 128 million in public money. What attempts have been made to identify what that money was spent on? I mean, when the company was nationalised, there was only, 8 million or something in total assets within that company, and yet substantial loans and substantial payments had been made, tens of millions. What attempts were made to find out if that money had been spent appropriately?
So I'll bring Dermot in here in terms of the loans and the tracking of where that money was being invested. In terms of the contract, the milestone payments, the 15 milestone payments that were set in the contract and CMAL's requirement under the contract as the buyer required that the builder submit to the buyer evidence to suggest that milestone had been reached and for the buyer to be satisfied that then a milestone payment could be made.
Faked. I mean, it's quite evident in the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee's report back in December 2020 that these milestones were fabricated. And there's further reference saying that this is not unusual in the industry. I mean, to me, it seems extraordinary.
So, again, this is an area where you'll no doubt wish to seek advice from CMAL as a procuring authority, but as I understand it, the procuring authority agreed in that negotiation period with FML what that milestone payment schedule should be, and those milestone payment schedules were tied to deliverables, whether that was equipment, whether that was certain level of fabrication. Now, I accept that within the Audit General's report there is... a definition which says, well, but what was that level of fabrication? And I guess that's the area where CMAL have worked hard now to try and tighten up on what those milestones should be and how you tie them to quality in future contracts. But you can't get away from the fact that the BIMCO new build contract is a fairly standard shipbuilding contract, unchanged, which includes the same terminology and language as you've seen in this contract here. So payment for... upfront payment for acquiring various bits of equipment and then various stage payments thereafter for certain build-out of the ship.
A quarter of the money put up front to enable them to purchase materials?
Again, that was the negotiation that was done between CMAL and FML.
I'm going to be asking questions of CMAL when I get the chance, but Transport Scotland had a responsibility in this as well.
Well, I'm sorry, we didn't. We weren't party to the procurement of the contract.
But so were you not the sponsor?
We were the sponsor body for CMAL in ensuring CMAL, mm-hmm. as our experts in shipbuilding, were undertaking the procurement and the work that they do in running CMAL appropriately. That's the role of TS.
Did you not have a concern that tens of millions of pounds were getting flushed down the toilet and, there was no way to ascertain what was happening with it?
Well, the contract was set by the builder and the buyer with the expert opinion on what those milestones should be and for what. And then it's the case of those payments to be made under the contract. And that once that contract starts, it's a very difficult contract to stop. So there is some suspension and termination rights within the contracts, and that's basically around lack of work for 14 days. Then the buyer has the ability to stop the contract and say, well, it doesn't look like there's going to be any more progress made. But once it starts, it's in both parties' interest to conclude that contract accordingly.
At what point did you become aware that relationships between CMAL and FMAL had broken down?
I would say that throughout 16, CMAL were reporting to, and again, I'll bring Fran in here just on that reporting mechanism to TS, but they were reporting on delays, but recoverable delays. It was towards the end of 16 where I, as CEO, became more aware that actually there's a greater risk that the delay was going to go beyond that first date for delivery. And in early 17, we reported that fact to the minister. So minister actually, I think, from recollection, actually visited the yard in 16. I think there's an exchange in the public record where the issue of delay was put to Mr. McCall directly, in which his response was, he was astounded to know, to hear that somebody was questioning whether or not the vessels were going to be delayed or not. And at that point, you could start to see the relationships between both parties drifting. And for the next 18 months, what I and TS and the DG Economy attempted to do was to try and broker a more harmonious relationship between those two parties and to try and get to a point where we could resolve some of the differences of opinion. I think you've seen from the response that Mr. McCall has sent into the committee that those differences of opinion on events remain. And I suspect that when you speak to CMAL, that will probably remain the case.
Just to clarify in my own mind, I recognise that CMAL obviously granted the contract, signed it off, managed it and so on. What reporting did they have to Transport Scotland in terms of the progress of that contract and the issues that were arising in that contract?
So I will bring Fran in on this point. Sorry, Fran, I forgot to bring you in. But the voted loan in the documentation explains the requirement for CMAL to update Transport Scotland and ministers on a regular basis, and there is a template in there which sets out what needs to be put forward. But Fran.
Yeah, so the voted loan sets out the requirement for monthly reporting from CMAL to Transport Scotland in their role as the creditor under the voted loan agreement, which had the requirement for updates on progress. In addition to that, CMAL would also report into the programme steering group, which had no formal role in the contract itself, but is a product of the tripartite, so Transport Scotland, CMAL and CalMAC coming together to look at the programme or the portfolio of investment across the network to make sure that that all works together and all parties with an interest are aware of progress and how that impacts on other projects and programmes within the portfolio.
Is monthly reporting normal?
So it was quarterly reporting, forgive me if I said monthly, it was quarterly reporting under the voted loan for 801 and 802. We have moved toward, in subsequent voted loans, that requirement has changed to monthly. But yes, that's standard. I think the point is that there is an active and a regular discussion around risks and governance. In addition to that formal written report, there would, of course, have been regular dialogue between the parties. It's quite short lines of communication, so people would have been aware of progress and issues in real time.
So at what point did Transport Scotland become concerned at the tenor of the reports that were going in, and what did Transport Scotland do?
So, again, wasn't present at the time, but my understanding, based on the documents and discussion with other members of the team, was that there were individual aspects of the programme that had slipped from quite early in the contract in around about December 2016 or thereabouts. At that point, it was reported to Transport Scotland that some of the delays to individual programme lines were likely to be irrecoverable, leading to changes in delivery dates under the contract. And at that point, we notified those concerns to Scottish ministers.
Approximate time?
Forgive me, maybe January, February 2017.
Yeah.
February.
Okay.
So within the contract, there is an allowance for allowable delays, so an acceptance that there will be potential overruns, and that allowable delays, I think at 16, December 16, CMAL were reporting that in their view, so this was, again, the Yard's view was entirely different, CMAL's view as a professional experts were looking at this and going, well, we can't see how this first boat could be delivered to the original date plus the allowable allowance for delay. So I think at that point that would have been, I'll get this right, May 17 would have moved to August 17, so the 3 months. But they couldn't see how that would be done at that point. And
my impression is that CMAL were actually raising concerns fairly consistently for an extended period. The question is, what was done about it? What intervention was taken to try and get this back on schedule? And given the fact that there was an awareness that CMAL's relationship with FMAL had broken down, that should have given an additional concern. And then on top of that, my understanding from the documents here is that CMAL wanted to stop the payments, took legal advice, which said that they had to continue the payments. I mean, all of this, didn't it raise a real concern as to what was happening?
Well, it did, yes. So the reporting that occurred over 16, CMAL were reporting their view on how the performance was going. FMAL had a different opinion on that. It's the builder is a private organisation. It's for them. It's to build the boats out. It's a design and build contract. They are in control of the build and the programme. And their view was different from CMAL's. At that point, the delays that were being reported were recoverable. So it was still early on in the gestation of this project. It's not unusual for major infrastructure. If I take Queensferry Crossing, for instance, over a six-year contract, we were only 10 weeks late. But we wouldn't have been concerned about some of that early delay early on in the gestation of that project. And similarly to this, it wasn't until CMAL had got to the point where they couldn't see that the original delivery date for 801 would be delivered. Now, I have to say, CMAL worked incredibly hard throughout the whole process to try and resolve and work together in a constructive way to make this contractor a success. So nobody wants a failed supplier. Everybody wants the outcome good on both sides of the buyer and the builder. And CMAL, I think, went a considerable way to try and assist both the builder in his cash flow issues, in his the design development which he was stuck with, but also in assisting with variations. So there were some variations that were, as been mentioned quite a bit in other reports, some variations that were actually to the benefit of the yard, actually should have speeded up the process. So I think CMAL in this case couldn't have done any more as a buyer to try and keep this contract in place and moving proactively forward.
And yet we ended up with a failed supplier. Just on a slightly different angle on the money, obviously a good chunk of the money that was paid out, they got most of the value of the vessels actually paid out to them. But they also got loan support. Now that wasn't visible to CMAL, as I understand, because commercial issues around it. So what was the rationale? I mean, who made the decision to give these loans to provide what is basically working capital? Who made these decisions and what were the loan conditions and were they adhered to?
So I'll bring Dermot in on this. So DG Economy, Liz Ditchburn, was responsible for oversight of the assistance to the economic asset that was the yard. It became clear in 17 that the contract had exhausted any further potential to assist in the yard. And I put a piece of advice up, accountable officer advice up, that kind of laid that out to say that actually CMAL's additional help that they had provided in trying to assist with milestone payments and the request that had come from CBC to remove the final guarantee, that could not go any further than that actually the contract was at its limit. There's no more that the contract could do to assist in assisting the supplier to deliver these vessels. That then moved it out of the territory of the contract into, well, the yard as an economic asset needs support, and that's where Dermot and the team and Liz looked into the loan issues. So those two issues, it was important to keep those two issues separately. And if I could just come back to something that you mentioned just at the end there about supplier failure, I think that is an area where it got touched on in the REC committee and it got touched again on the Audit Scotland report. But what I've seen through both the programme turnaround work, the work that Tim Hare did, the assessment of work that's still required now on 801, there is a fundamental issue there around the builder understanding the simple terms of the contract, which was a 100-metre boat to go 16 and a half knots to carry 1,000 people and for that to be delivered for a price of £97 million. And how they went about that, that's an issue that I think is probably one that, well, you'll no doubt wish to ask CMAL questions around that. But, Dermot, sorry, you're sitting there.
You asked about the purpose of the loan and who signed it off. So Roy has covered the in terms of putting up the advice. It came from DG Economy initially on the first loan and then from the Director of Economic Development, Colin Cook's predecessor, on the second loan. And the loans were approved by the Cabinet Secretary, Derek Mackay. The purpose of the loan, as Roy said, there's two types of contracts. So there's a contract for the build, that's a procurement. The loans are not a procurement, they were an investment into the business. So the purpose was
purchase of shares, stock, or was it...
Initially, it was debt. So we reviewed the business case of the business, and essentially, when their business were taking on debt, we wanted to understand whether the business, through its business plan, would be able to repay that debt, and the government would earn a commercial return.
Did CBC put any money into this?
CBC had initially capitalised the business, so we...
How much was that?
The figure that I've heard CBC talk about was around £25 million. That was, I think, understood their initial capitalisation of the business. And then, as we negotiated the second loan, under the terms of the second loan, CBC were due to put in £8.5 million into the business.
Did they do so?
No, they didn't. They didn't put in the 8.5. What they did in the end is they put in £3 million worth of money, and that went in as debt rather than as equity, which was their... our original agreement.
So, actually, the terms of the loan were not fulfilled by the supplier?
The loan... The terms of the second loan, CBC defaulted on the second loan, the business defaulted, so they didn't... In October 2018, when the business, FML, had drawn down £17 million from the loan facility, second loan facility, at that point, there was an obligation on the business and its shareholder to put in £1.7 million to subscribe capital, up to £1.7 million of new equity. They defaulted on that condition, and at that point, drawdown of the remainder of the second loan was suspended until we renegotiated with CBC, and ultimately they put in £3 million, not as equity but as debt, and we agreed that, but that debt was to rank behind the Scottish Government's debt.
I mean, we're talking about loans here, but was there ever a prospect that we're going to be repaid? I mean, here we had a business which was clearly suffering from lack of liquidity and needed all sorts of concessions on its contract in order to get payments to keep it ticking over. And yet, we're giving them loans. I mean, on what rational financial basis was that done?
So we studied the business plan of the business. For the second loan particularly, we were looking at a long-term plan, you know, over the next 10 years. What was clear, and the business were clear about it, was they did not anticipate making any margin at all on contracts 801, 802. So essentially, by taking on the debt, the debt from the government, they were essentially foregoing future profits that would come back to the government. Now, these profits were to be earned on subsequent contracts. Now, at that time, the business was bidding for quite a lot of work. They did win some work in that period. They won work on an air cushioned barge, and they won some work, two vessels, Invalusa vessels, and they had some other fabrication work. But essentially, the loans weren't going to be paid back from the completion of ATO1, ATO2. They were going to be paid back over the subsequent period, over future years, as the business won more work. So the risk for the business and for the directors taking on that loan was to be sure that they could pay those debts as they fell due. And the risk for the government was that we had to believe in the business plan and believe that the loans could be paid back. And we,
did you believe in it?
Well, we sought advice from PwC. They reviewed the business plan for us, and they said there was a prospect of us getting a return on that money. That obviously has not proven to be the case. Some of the money we've been able to recover, some of the debt via the money that was offset against the loan for not buying the business, and an amount of money too that's come back via the administration.
Now, PwC must have given a written opinion. Is it possible to see that?
Yes. So the report that we had from PwC, I think, would be dated May 2018. It's referred to in advice that was put, it may have been April 2018. It was referred to in the advice that Colin Cook's predecessor, Mayor McCallan, put to ministers recommending the second loan, and it's referred to in there.
It would be interesting to see the recommendation as well.
The recommendation from the civil servants? Yes, it's all put down in Mary McCallan's submission. I think that is of April 2018.
And that's on the public record?
That's on the public record and the FML documents that we've published.
Okay.
Colin, I'm conscious of the time.
Okay.
And we've got two members of the committee that I'm keen to bring in before we finish up. So, I don't know, Willie, do you want to go next? Yeah.
Thanks again, convener. I wonder if I could just raise again the issue about the application of quality standards that Colin Beattie led on just a moment ago there. The Auditor General and his key messages told us that some of the project milestones were not clearly defined, and there was no linkage, in fact, to any quality standards that may be an accepted part of that particular industry. Do you have a view on that, Roy, about why we weren't insisting on a connection between the milestones in the project and quality standards that should have been applicable at each point?
Again, my background is civil engineering and highways and transport, but as I can understand the shipbuilding contract, the standard shipbuilding contract, then I think there's a quite a clear clause at the start which talks about standard shipbuilding conditions, so actually building the ships as you would expect to see built, shipped by competent yards, and I suspect that that's a lot of that is rested within the contracts and the way that these contracts are held between the buyer and the builder. The Auditor General has picked up on the point that, well, surely there's an opportunity there to review that standard BIMCO contract and strengthen it, and CMAL and O have looked at that, and I'll bring Fran in again on the Isle of Vessels to see what more has been done. But what's evident, and that's what we saw through the turnaround director's report, was there was a substantial amount of work which was not done in that kind of sequence or in that generalised way of how you would have put the boat together. Now, that's no reflection on the workforce in the yard. They built what they were asked to build. I suspect that's more about how it was planned and how it was project managed through that period of time. But the contract is silent on that. So the contract does not allow CMAL, as the buyer, to interfere in the builder's approach to building. The CMAL are allowed within the contract to ask for variations, and the builder is entirely entitled to refuse those variations or to continue on if he feels that those variations are going to impact on the contract itself. And there is a dispute mechanism in the contract. So in my parallel world of civils and transport projects, a kind of very similar approach to how you deal with disputes, variations, costings, payment for those, but nothing that would allow the buyer to actually intervene in quality control as per se. But Fran.
Thanks, Roy. So there are has been, as you would expect, a significant degree of reflection on what could be done better or lessons that might have been learned from 801 and 802. And again, I would defer to CMAL on the detailed specification of all of this, but we have reflected collectively upon this very point around quality and how we tie those to milestone events. So as part of the reflection, we did discuss whether or not it would be prudent to modify what is an internationally recognised BIMCO contract to be more explicit in relation to quality standards. And the feedback from CMAL as our industry experts is that that would have the unintended consequence of potentially deterring bidders or distorting the contract price, but a different way to achieve the same outcome, which we now see in relation to Isla and we will see in relation to future vessels, is to make sure that those milestone payment dates under the contract are explicitly linked to quality. So future contract milestone events will rely upon a certificate being prepared by the builder, which has to be signed off by the attending classification society before payment is made. Now, that might have been assumed, and that's typically the practice that would have existed under BIMCO anyway, through that general quality reference that Roy set out. But making that, we can certainly make that more explicit in terms of the milestone payments going forward. Mm. But I'm sure that's something that CMAL will be able to speak to more eloquently than I.
Okay, I mean, it's a recurring issue at our committee that when we look at any project, we very often find, Roy, that if the project goes wrong at the beginning, it's unlikely to work at the end, and there's a lack of sufficiency of rigour being applied at the outset, and in particular in the absence of applying quality standards to milestones, would seem to members of this committee as to be a major issue. And one of the examples that the Auditor General listed in his report in paragraph 138, it told us that some of the 1,400 cables installed in the first boat were too short. And it's just amazing to members of the committee and perhaps to the public as to how that wasn't discovered. And in fact, it wasn't reported to the Parliament until the turnaround director was involved, and that was 2022. How on earth can something like that happen, that cables that are too short can go unseen and unnoticed for nearly 4 years and cause that significant delay to occur? Now, I would connect that directly with the application of quality standards and inspection and so on and so forth. Why was that missing in this case, do we think?
So, again, it's commenting more generally on states, different types of contract, but this BIMCO new build contract is a design and build contract. So once the tenderer takes the concept design or the outline design, he then owns that design. So his responsibility is to produce the outcomes that are set in the front page of the contract, and it's entirely up to him how he does that and how he goes about that. And the payments and the final payment is based on what that end product is. There isn't an allowance for CMAL, if I'm correct in saying this, to actually judge how he goes about that as he delivers the final product, because it's a complete design and build system. What you might argue is that there would have been an opportunity there, and there was, for CMAL to be in or about the yard. They have, I think, within the contract allows them an individual to be in and about the yard to witness this. Now they can witness it, and they were recording issues that were going on with the build, but there isn't a mechanism, as far as I can see, in the contract to halt that. So suspension termination is set out, can't remember quite what the clause is, but it's very clear about those terms of when the buyer is able to trigger a stop of the contract and a repayment of the fees. One is a default or refund guarantee. Second is lack of work for more than 14 days. And I've forgotten the third one. But it doesn't specifically talk about quality or specification as a trigger mechanism for halting the contract.
Well, I suppose the last question on that is, shouldn't it? I mean, it surely must be a ridiculous position to not be able to challenge the fact that cables are too short on a boat and for that to remain in position for 4 years until somebody else comes on the scene, the turnaround director, to identify that. Surely that must be something that we're looking at. I'm aware that the observation reports were a mechanism, really, to raise and highlight issues. Those are essentially change requests in the quality world. and they may or may not have been carried out by the builder, but surely to goodness that area, whole area needs to be strengthened.
So the ORR, you're absolutely right, the ORRs are the mechanism by which the buyer is able to identify those issues that they are unhappy with and they need to be rectified before the boats would be taken into ownership. So that was fully documented. CMAL were religious with identifying what those ORRs are and asking that the builder corrected those before the boats would have been handed over. So none of those issues would have materialised in the final boats if it had gotten as far as that, but that's the mechanism. Whether the BIMCO contract needs to change to deal with this more explicitly, again, that's maybe a question that is for our shipbuilding experts of CMEL that you speak to Kevin and others around. Mm-hmm.
Is it accepted, this whole point that the Auditor General made, is that accepted by all parties that these cables were too short, or is there some dispute about that?
Maybe defer to Mo on what the yard's current position is in relation to those cables, but I think certainly CMAL had understood and had identified that the cables were too short, so I think it's accepted, but again others
won't. Even by the builder, they accepted that the cables were too short.
So I forgive me, I don't know whether it's accepted by former management FMAIL when it's understood the cables were put in, but it's certainly, to my understanding, accepted by the current management team at the yard.
Can we bring Mo Rooney in at this point, please? Mo.
Yes, thank you. So we don't know what happened with the cables in the first instance. They were installed prior to Ferguson's coming into public ownership. As we understand it, it is standard practice that when these cables are fitted, they are left with a bit of excess. They were fitted by reputable contractors, so it was assumed that these coils that were rolled up that they included the length of cable that was required. So this issue wasn't discovered until an inspection in January, or so I understand sort of tail end of December, when these were unrolled and measured, and it was at that point that issue was discovered. So we don't know how that's come about, but as I say, they were installed by reputable contractors and there were assumptions made on that basis.
Okay, we can probably further investigate that in the next session. Convener, thanks very much. Back to you.
Yep, thanks very much indeed, Willie. We've only got a couple of minutes left, and we've got a large... there are large areas of the report, for example, on nationalisation, the lead-up to nationalisation and so on, and Colin Cook's been noticeably silent today. It may be that we will require a further session just to complete the evidence gathering that we'd like to get through. But I'm going to conclude today's proceedings by inviting Sharon Dowie to ask any outstanding questions that she's got. Sharon.
Hi, thanks. Just a wee question on the Eric Ostergaard email that was sent on the 26th of September. He makes it quite clear that the contract should not go ahead, and in your evidence that you've given today, you're referring to CMAL as the experts in shipbuilding. So why would their recommendations have been ignored?
So again, I'll come back to the timeline of that. So Eric had, at that point, reflected where things were with the negotiations, as I understand it. By the time that the advice had got to ministers, those negotiations had moved on sufficiently enough that CMAL executive and the board were content with what they had managed to negotiate with the builder at that time. So that's, again, coming back to some of the previous evidence, that seems to be where the gestation of the movement from where it was to where it got to before the advice went to minister. But Fran, anything else you want to add?
No, I think that's a fair summary. So at the point of that note that you referenced, the board had been clear that they felt the risks were unacceptable. That was followed by a period of negotiation where mitigation was put in place, the mitigation in relation to alternative forms of guarantee, and also modifications to the voted loan that provides CMAL with greater assurance. Those risks got to a position where the board ultimately concluded that they were content with the risks remained, but the risks at that stage were acceptable and they were content to proceed. And it was on that basis that Transport Scotland officials put advice to ministers on the 8th of October. That advice ultimately was accepted.
Can I ask if there was a meeting held between everybody like CMAL, Transport Scotland, the ministers? Did they all come together in a meeting to discuss all the issues that they had?
Not that I can see from the paperwork. So the paperwork is as in front of us, but
again, not that I'm aware of. My expectation would be that had there been a meeting engaging ministers at which decisions were taken, that that would have been minuted. I haven't seen any evidence of that. I expect, and I think I understand from the exchanges, there would, of course, have been regular dialogue between CMAL and Ferguson's. Transport Scotland wouldn't have been privy to that, but there was regular engagement between Transport Scotland and CMAL, and ultimately the output of that is all recorded in the submission of the 8th of October.
So even though all the issues have been handed to the ministers, then they've not actually had an in-person meeting to discuss it with the experts in shipbuilding. Right. Just going on to the email for October 2015, the 8th, an email sent to Dennett McKay and Keith Brown. The senders redacted along with a list of other people who were also copied in the correspondence, but it states that the DFM approved the financial implications of the contract award prior to the announcement by the FM on the 31st of August that FML was the preferred bidder. It goes on to say still that it's clear the board of CMAL are still concerned. And at the end, it asks for the minister's confirmation that he's aware of the issues and is content to give approval to proceed, and also asks if the minister wanted to speak to a representative of the CMAL board. So would it be fair to say that it's the Deputy First Minister that was made fully aware of the financial implications prior to the announcement by the First Minister, so he's the one that's authorised the contract to go ahead?
No, so as I come back to the evidence previously, the DFM's role was in making sure that the finance was available to continue forward with the procurement.
But with the financial implications of it, it looks as if the ministers haven't been happy with the financial implications, so they've then handed it over to the Deputy First Minister to give authorisation.
Well, I don't have that bit of paper in front of me, but I don't see that's the reading of it. I think, as I said, that DFM's role in this was to ensure that the finance and the budget was available for the procurement to continue on. So one of the issues is that is the authorising environment, i.e. is the money available to take forward this project? That's quite rightly an issue for the DFM, as the budget, the Cabinet Secretary for Finance, was the budget available? The decision on whether to proceed with the procurement is the Minister's.
Right. And again, at the end of this letter, are you aware if the meeting was requested with CMAL and if it took place?
We've found no evidence that there was a meeting that took place between ministers and CMAL.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, well, thank you. I mean, I guess my only final question, Roy Brannan, to you is just to ask if, was it in your gift to advise ministers to terminate the contract? And if it was that something that crossed your mind to do?
So it wasn't within my gift, it was within CMAL's gift as the party to the procurement. And I apologies if I keep restating this, but Transport Scotland were not a party to the contract. So buyer, CMAL, builder, FML, within the terms of the contract, it is entirely right that CMAL could have triggered a termination or a suspension of the contract. And I think I've mentioned a couple of times now what those conditions were. If there was no work undertaken in the yard for more than 14 days, then CMAL could have triggered a cancellation of the contract and requested all their money back. So I think another important thing here, that within the contract clauses, even though you had a refund guarantee, partial refund guarantee, the contract clauses still require the contractor to repay if there is a suspension or termination. That would have just meant that the yard would have had to find the money to pay back the buyer, CMAL, and probably in that space then the yard would insolvency a much earlier process. So it was an area that was considered. It was one of the options that was looked at by PwC in the 29 options that they put forward. And it was one of the three recommendations, but discounted because of the impact that would have on, at that point, not just the vessels, but the vessels, the yard and the jobs. Those three things were interlinked throughout the course of the project itself.
But you kind of recuse Transport Scotland from that. But you, as the accountable officer, gave advice in, I think it was April 2017, the end of April 2017, which is amongst those 200 odd documents that are now in the public domain, where you said that if flexibility on the surety bond was going to be introduced, then you would require written authority for that.
Correct. And I was pretty clear in that advice that there was no more flex within the contract. The contract, CMAL, had gone as far as they possibly could. and I couldn't see how they could do anything more than that. If there was a requirement, if I had been required to ask CMAL to remove the surety bond, then I would have sought a written authorisation to do that. And clearly, my recommendation up was that that should not be touched. And there was no issue with that at all. Ministers didn't ask me to do anything more with that. They accepted the recommendation. What I also go to say in that piece of advice was that I expected that there would need to be some other intervention or assistance to make sure that this was going to be a successful outcome. So I think at that point I was pretty clear that the contract had gone as far as it possibly could.
But your recommendation was, or what happened was, at that stage, a reprofiling of the, as you called it, or an acceleration, as many others would call it, of the payments to FML.
So CMAL had suggested, had put forward the proposal to bring forward some of the payment for additional milestones, strictly controlled by CMAL, title taken by CMAL on them, and clearance processes in place to make sure that money was apportioned to the title of whatever it was, parts manufacturing, that were coming through the business. So there was no new cash into the business from the contract, same contract value, just a reprofiling. And in actual fact, CMAL controlled that very well, because there was a couple of items that had come forward from the yard for work that was not connected with those milestones, and they were refused by CMAL. So my position on that approach to ministers was CMAL proposing that this was something they could do to, again, assist the builder to continue on to deliver the outcomes successfully for these vessels. And my view was, as the AO, is that proportionate? Is it manageable? Is it balance of risk? And out of all of those issues that had come forward, the only ones I could hand on heart say that would assist at that point were the reprofiling. The surety guarantee could not be touched.
But as part of that arrangement, that new arrangement, wasn't there a commitment given to CMAL that they would be compensated, their budget would be increased to accommodate that change in the profiling of the payments?
There's no new money. So the voted loan, the totality of the voted loan was exactly the same. So it brought forward what would have been in the final payment into an earlier part of the budget year. But that was only a reprofiling of the totality of the voted loan. There was no new money into the system.
And just finally on this point, because this has been brought up, I think, in the Audit Scotland report, which is around the fact that there were 15 intervals of payment rather than typically five. Again, can you just, for the record, tell us the reasons for that?
So that's a question you need to put to CMAL. I mean, that's a normal practice is between buyer and builder. They agree what the milestone payment should be based on what the builder will expect to have in place by either engines or equipment, or when he anticipates he will need a kind of flow of cash to allow that to be successfully built. Ships are expensive, they cost a lot of money, and they have a lot of upfront costs, so it's entirely right that the builder and the buyer agree what that milestone schedule is. And in this case, they agreed on 15 payments.
Okay. I mean, I think one of the things I've drawn from today is that there seems to be a lot of responsibility and accountability placed at the level of the builder and the buyer, but the whole apparatus of accountability in the civil service doesn't seem to have been applied.
To the point of the award, and once it becomes a contract, the contract, and this is in all other cases, so...
But it's gone from £97 million to 2.5 times that much.
Indeed. So the contract, the failure of the contract is something that is has been part of that process. So contracts that I direct control over, Scottish ministers direct control over contracts like Queen's Ferry Crossing, for instance, we would be acting in exactly the same way as CMAL on those issues. So if Queen's Ferry Crossing, for instance, was 10 weeks late on a 6-year contract, which is those issues, those delays, I would have been dealing with as the buyer and the builder, Queen's Ferry Crossing Contractor Consortium. We'd have been in those discussions about how to make sure we maintain progress on the contract. Civil service doesn't have a role in contracts that have TS or SG, have a role in the contracts that are procured by our agency, CMAL, and private organisations, directly in the contract. We have oversight of the sponsored body, and that's entirely appropriate to make sure that the sponsored body does not act inappropriately. So they are not making payments that are not linked to progress or are not linked to the contract itself.
Mr. Brown, on that note, which is where we may pick things up again in the future, can I thank you very much indeed for your time and the evidence that you've given us this morning, and can I thank all the members of the team that joined you, including Mo Rooney, who gave a contribution towards the end. As I said, we've got whole areas of the report which we think are important for us to interrogate, and that's one of the reasons why Mr. Cook wasn't called this morning. But I'm sure that we will get back in touch, Mr. Branner, to see if we can arrange a follow-up session, because I think there have been lots of important issues raised this morning, but some of the ground that we need to cover we haven't quite got to. But can I thank you once again for your time, and I now close the public part of this morning's session. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you.